Bible or Bible app, let's go together to the New Testament, the book of Colossians. We're going to be in the letter that Paul wrote to the church at Colossae, Colossians chapter 1, and we're going to look at verses 24 through 27 in just a moment. As you find that, what I like to do from time to time is to let you know where we are going from here. This morning we are wrapping up our series Easter Encounter. Next Sunday we'll have a special message that is designed for our groundbreaking Sunday for our For the Future expansion project. And so then beginning in May and the four Sundays in the month of May, which do include Mother's Day and Graduate Sunday, we're going to be looking at what it looks like for spiritual growth. And I think that's so important for us as a church and as believers coming out of a special week and with Encounter and Ronnie Hill and following Easter and the excitement that comes with that. I think it's important that we always remember that when we stop learning, we stop growing. And so spiritual growth is important to the life of every believer. Well, this morning, though, we've got to focus on this last part of our Easter Encounter series. And, you know, Easter weekend on the calendar is over. The Easter sales are done. But listen, if you are a follower of Jesus Christ, every day of your life should be an Easter. There's so much to celebrate. A Sunday school teacher asked her class the Sunday after Easter to write one sentence on what Easter means to me. A young boy wrote egg salad sandwiches for the next 2 weeks. Now, you know, as a child, I think I probably had that same very understanding of Easter. But as I've grown in my relationship with the Lord, Easter means something different to me now. You see, Easter is the restoration of hope. That's Easter. In a nutshell, it is the restoration of hope. Someone was quoted as saying that we can live 40 days without food, 8 days without water, 4 minutes without air, but only 1 second without hope. I love what Thornton Wilde was quoted when he wrote, "Despair all too readily embraces the ills it foresees. Hope is an energy that arouses the mind to explore every possibility to combat those ills." Think for a moment about the people who were part of that first Easter. They knew all too well their need for hope in order to just continue the journey. They had knelt there at the foot of the cross, watching the one who carried all of their hopes and dreams die on a cross. They had listened to Christ in His words when He said, "Father, into Your hands I commend my spirit." And then they saw Him bow His head and take His last breath. Their guts wrenched as the Roman soldier plunged the spear into His side, removing all doubt that Jesus was truly dead. And they followed those who carried Him to the tomb. They heard the resounding sound of the rock that sealed that tomb. And they knew in that moment, they felt their hope was dead. Sealed in the tomb was their hope with the one they thought would be the Savior of the world. And they knew right then what it was like to be hopeless. Some of you maybe know that feeling all too well of hopelessness. You look at your marriage relationship and all you see is despair and struggle and difficulty. You think about your children, whether they are still young or fully grown, and you wonder, will you ever have a relationship with them again? Will they once again turn their life to Christ? Will they follow Him and trust Him? What kind of future does God have for them? And when you consider your own life and the mistakes that you have made, you're tempted to give up hope. Can anyone love me? Will anyone forgive me? Will something good ever come out of my life? You been there? Well, this morning, my desire for us in our time together is that we will experience the same restoration of hope that those first century Christians experienced when they came to the tomb and they heard those words, "He is not here. He is risen, just as he said." Friends, they discovered that day that there is hope beyond the cross. And what you are going through or whatever you have done does not destroy you and should not steal your hope. You can have hope, but you find it beyond the cross and beyond that Easter. Look with me as Paul wrote to this great church in Colossians chapter 1, beginning in verse 24. Paul says, "Now I rejoice in my sufferings for your sake, and in my flesh I do my share on behalf of his body, which is the church, in filling up what is lacking in Christ's afflictions. Of this church I was made a minister according to the stewardship from God bestowed on me for your benefit, so that I might fully carry out the preaching of the word of God." Verse 26, "That is the mystery which has been hidden from the past ages and generations, but now has been manifested to his saints, to whom God willed to make known what the riches of the glory of this mystery among the Gentiles, which is Christ in you, the hope of glory." If you're taking notes on the backside of your worship guide, we've provided you a place to do that. And here's the first thought as we look beyond the cross and the restoration of hope is that hope endures even through suffering. One of the things that threatens you the most to steal your hope is suffering and trials and tribulations and difficult circumstances that come your way. Suffering has been part of what it means to be a human ever since sin entered this world. And even though Jesus paid for our sins on the cross with his own blood, suffering is present with us and will be with us until this very world is a part of history. You can let suffering steal your hope. Or you can hold on to the hope that you have in Christ that comes beyond the cross and concentrate on enduring through those suffering times and those suffering moments. That's what Paul writes in that. "Now I rejoice in my sufferings." Now he's not saying that I celebrate what I'm going through. It's not that I have a party about all of that I'm experiencing. But Paul is in prison and he's saying, because of Christ, I can rejoice in what I'm going through. I know that it is making a difference in my life. It's making a difference in your life, in the life of the church. And so a couple of side notes, if you will, on how hope endures through suffering is that suffering can bring a believer, a follower of Jesus, closer to Christ. Philippians 3:10. "Because of that, and his blood, the power of his resurrection, and the fellowship of" what? "His sufferings." Now, when we think of fellowships, we think of little, you know, casserole dishes and down in the Family Life Center and having a good time. It's hard to think of fellowship in his sufferings. But it is a partnership. It is a relationship that I can endure all things because Christ who gives me strength, it's a fellowship in the rejoicing of the privilege of this journey with him. Suffering teaches us total dependence on Jesus. I love the song that Melissa sang. "When did I forget that you've always been the King of the world?" In those moments of suffering and struggle, it's easy to forget, right? We focus on the struggle. But we have to remember the hope that endures in our sufferings is that Christ is the King of the world. You don't have to answer this question out loud or even raise your hand, but just to think about it for a moment. How many of us have been through circumstances where you knew that you would have never made it through if it was to be without the Lord being there with you? You've been there? I have. You know you would have never made it through if Jesus hadn't been there with you. And you could suffer through that. Suffering brings you closer to Christ. And suffering, though, also assures the believer that they belong to Christ. John 15, 18, Jesus said that we should expect persecution and suffering. Listen, they persecuted Jesus. And he promises us that we will be persecuted as well. Look at what he says. Sufferings for your sake and in my flesh, I do my share on behalf of his body, which is the church, in filling up what is lacking in Christ's afflictions. Listen, there are going to be afflictions. As long as sin and death are in this world, there will be heartache and difficulty. And you endure those things because of what Christ said, this will happen. In this world, you will have trouble. But take heart, I've overcome the world. What he's saying is, take heart. You can have hope beyond the cross. You can endure all things in your sufferings because of what I've done. It's the fellowship of joining with him. Paul is not saying that Jesus' death and resurrection were not sufficient to pay for our salvation. That's not what he's saying. What he's saying is that you are going to suffer because of his salvation. If you trust in that, if you hold on to that, that the world will hate us, is what Scripture says. And until that cup of hate has been filled up, then God won't return, because when he does return, he's going to pour out his judgment on the world. Suffering reminds the believer that this world is not our home. This is not our final destination. And it challenges each of us and produces the hope within us. Hold your finger there at Colossians and turn over to Romans 5. I think it's important for us to remind ourselves of this passage again that Paul writes. But in Romans 5, verses 2 through 5, look at what he says. Through whom also we have obtained our introduction by faith into grace in which we stand. And we exhort in the hope of the glory of God. And not only this, but we also exult in our tribulations, knowing that tribulation brings about perseverance, and perseverance proven character, and proven character hope. Verse 5, and hope does not disappoint, because the love of God has been poured out within our hearts through the Holy Spirit, who has given us hope. Friends, you've got to hold on to that and endure the sufferings beyond the cross. Every time you make it over some obstacle in your life, it gives you hope. It empowers you to make it over that next obstacle that comes your way. It's like running the hurdles in track. And when you're faced with a situation that threatens to steal your hope, friends, just look back. Look back at all those other times when you thought there was no hope and you'd never get over that obstacle. You'd never get beyond that. And yet you made it through, didn't you? You made it over it. Listen, God is still the same God he has always been. His power is still available to you. You can make it through whatever you're struggling with right now. There's hope beyond the cross. Suffering captures the attention of unbelievers and can possibly lead them into a relationship with Christ. Someone here this morning may be wrestling and struggling, and they don't really know Jesus as their personal Savior. Right now, you're one of three people. You're either in the middle of a struggle in your life, you're coming out of a struggle, or you're headed into one. It's the circle of life. But it's in those struggles that God whispers and says, I've got this. You can endure. Don't ignore that voice. Whatever situation you might be facing right now, you will get through this. there's hope beyond the cross. And beyond the cross, hope sustains our purpose. That's the second thought this morning. Look again at verse 25 in Colossians 1. Paul defines his purpose. Of this church, I was made a minister according to the stewardship from God bestowed on me for your benefit. So what? So that I might fully carry out the preaching of the Word of God. Hope has endured through the sufferings that I have experienced and the afflictions that have come my way. But hope sustains me in the purpose that God has given me. A study that was done of concentration camp survivors led to the discovery of some common characteristics of those who did not succumb to disease and starvation while in those camps. Viktor Frankl was a living answer to the question that they wrestled with. What are those common characteristics? In a speech he gave after his release, and you can find this speech in his book, Man's Search for Meaning. Viktor writes, "There is only one reason why I am here today. What kept me alive was you. Others gave up hope." He writes about one morning, a prisoner just simply refused to give up or to get up. He wouldn't get dressed or wash or go outside to the parade grounds. No amount of pleading by his fellow prisoners would help. No threatening by his captors would have any effect. Losing all hope, he simply had given up. He would lay there until he died. The American soldiers call it give up it is. But Frankl refused to give up. He writes, I dreamed that someday I would be here telling you how I, Viktor Frankl, had survived the Nazi concentration camps. I've never been here before. I've never seen any of you before. I've never given this speech before. But in my dreams, I stood before you. And in my dreams, I said these words 1,000 times. He had established a purpose for himself, a purpose for the struggles in that concentration camp. And that purpose kept his hopes alive through everything that he endured and he faced. Paul had a purpose. He was given this purpose by God himself. He was to be the servant to the churches, delivering a message of hope to them, helping them grow and advance their faith and advance the kingdom. Paul went through a lot of pain in his life in order to fulfill that purpose. He was stoned, imprisoned, beaten, betrayed, shipwrecked. But Paul never lost hope. He had a purpose, and that purpose kept him going. Listen, Jesus had a purpose, my friends. And that purpose was to seek and to save that which was lost. He came for you and me. Jesus knew that there was hope for every situation that you face. It was the hope that kept him going to the cross so that he would fulfill his very purpose for coming to this earth. Hebrews 12:2 says that Jesus endured the cross because of the joy that was set before him. He endured the cross because he was anticipating the joy of having you and me as a part of his family. And he looked beyond the cross and he walked out of that tomb for your hope and for mine. Friends, you have a purpose in this life. You are not here by accident. You were made in the image of God. Sustain that hope so that you might fulfill your purpose. A final thought this morning as we look at this passage is that beyond the cross, that hope reveals the truth. I love verse 26, where he says, the preaching of God's word, that's my purpose, that's my mission. It's the mystery which has been hidden from past ages and generations, but has now been manifested to his saints. The mystery of what? The mystery of the gospel. That Jesus would be sent as the only Son of God for the salvation of the world. That mystery is now revealed. And it's beyond the tomb that we find the truth, to whom God willed to make known, as he says, what is the riches of the glory of this mystery among the Gentiles, which is Christ in you, the hope of glory. You ask yourself, maybe hope reveals what truth? Truth about ourselves. Maybe you can identify with the little boy who was overheard talking to himself as he strutted through the backyard wearing his baseball cap and toting a baseball bat and ball. He said out loud, I'm the greatest hitter in the world. And he tossed the ball into the air and he swung at it and missed. Strike one, he yelled. Undaunted, he picked up the ball and said again, I'm the greatest hitter in the world. And he tossed the ball into the air, and when it came down, he swung again and he missed. Strike two, he cried. And then the boy paused for a moment to examine his bat and his ball, spit on his hands and rubbed them together, straightened his hat, and he said once more, I'm the greatest hitter in the world. And he tossed the ball in the air, swung at it, and he missed again. Strike three. And instead of falling into despair, with all the hope that children have today, he said, I am the greatest pitcher in the world. Children are full of hope, aren't they? What about you? Do you have that childlike hope that throughout those despairs, throughout those times where in life you have struck out, that you'd simply be able to say, I'm the greatest pitcher in the world. I see the truth of the hope of glory in me. You know, somewhere along the way, though, we as adults tend to believe the lies that have been spewed upon us. Lies that we're no good. Lies will never amount to anything. Lies you had your one chance and you blew it. Lies that no one wants to be in a relationship with you. You might as well go hide under a rock and die. You're of no value unless I can get something out of you. And those lies will steal your truth. They will steal your hope. But you have value. You do have potential. And when I remember that about myself and about others, it gives me hope. It blocks out the lies so that I can see the truth of who I am in Christ. You cannot alter your past, but you can punish your future if you lose hope. If you buy the lies, you lose your purpose and you cave to your sufferings. You will punish your future. And there are people in this world all around us. And a lot of times we say they're looking for love in all the wrong places. And oh, friends, that's true. But they're looking for hope in all the wrong places as well. False hopes are probably worse than having no hope at all. Someone has said that probably nothing in this world arouses more false hope than the first few hours of a diet. You been there? And when false hope comes crashing to the ground, it makes us think there is no secure and safe place for us to go where we will find real, true hope. Question is there anything, any hope beyond the cross? Yes. There is an empty tomb and a risen Savior. There's hope. There's a song that is called Beyond the Cross. And the chorus goes like this. Beyond the cross is a tomb that is empty. You won't find me there anymore. Beyond the tomb is life everlasting and hope forevermore. Let's pray together. Father, we thank you that you have revealed the mystery of the gospel. And that revelation comes through your Son, Jesus Christ. The one who endured all things that we might find hope beyond the cross.